Chris will do it for you. Yeah? Yeah, Chris will do it for you. What is Father Moon?
Good morning and welcome here to St Mary's on this, the fourth Sunday of Advent. The notices are on the reverse of the service. We will be having in person a midnight mass at 11 o'clock on Thursday and services at 10 on Friday on Christmas Day. I will just have to remind you that the doors are closed and locked when a service begins, so that please don't be late. And once we're at capacity, which is 60 people for any service, then we do have to again lock the doors. And that's particularly for those who want to come at midnight mass, that can often attract a lot of people. So we have to stay within the rules to keep everyone safe. Thank you for those who've contributed to the retiring collection for the Salvation Army. Thus far, we have raised in excess of £200 for the Salvation Army. And finally today, there will be an opportunity to give in the retiring collection. I must now publish the banns of marriage. I publish the banns of marriage between Martin Harrison and Nicola Andrea Baker, both of the parish of St. John the Evangelist, Perrybar. These are for the third time of asking. If any person knows any reason in law why these persons may not marry, you are to hear it. So we pray for them. We pray that for Martin and Nicola in their preparations for marriage, that you will be with them and be their guide. And in these extraordinary times, their commitment to each other will be celebrated with all the love and integrity of a couple who love each other. And while they can't have the wedding they planned to have, they can still be committed in God's eyes. And for that we ask your blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we light the fourth of the Advent candles. People of God, prepare. God above all, maker of all, is one with us in Christ. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. God, the mighty God, bends down in love to earth. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. God with us, God beside us, come soon to the world he has made. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. We are God's children. We seek the coming Christ. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. The service of nine lessons and carols later today will only be available as an online service. Please do tune in if you can. We are to be graced with the presence of the Mayor of the West Midlands, having given up John Lewis and John Lewis' life after him. He is now going to come and read one of our lessons. So we are obviously chosen and special. We'll quieten our hearts and then we will stand with all the turmoil around us, to declare our dependence on God, when we will sing, God is working his purpose out as year succeeds to year. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of your kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And so on this fourth Sunday we pray, God our Redeemer, who prepared the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of your Son, grant that as she looked for his coming as our Saviour, so we may be ready to greet him when he comes again as our Judge, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please sit for the readings.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But at that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from the following sheep, to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and we will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more. As formerly, from the time that I appoint judges over my people Israel, and I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. He has looked with favour on his lowly servant. All generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm, and has scattered the proud in their conceit, casting down the mighty from their thrones and lifting up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty. He has come to the aid of his servant Israel to remember his promise of mercy, the promise made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his children forever. A reading from the Epistle to the Romans. Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you. But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of the Lord.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our King and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, here's the sermon for today. Are you ready for it? I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the virgin birth. If you remember nothing else, that is the message you need to carry with you in your hearts. But of course, you know me too well. Quite. When I say I believe in the virgin birth, I say much more about God than I do about myself. The heart of our faith is not what we think is possible, but what we think God can do. Could we? Should we? Trust a God that is limited to what we can imagine or contain what we can understand. What a feeble God that would be. There aren't many Mensa members in the Church of England, particularly not in the bench of bishops. Could you imagine if God was limited to what a bishop could imagine? I think most of them have lost all imagination. Oops, sorry, we're on live stream. If we can say that we believe in a God that created the universe, whether he took 7 24-hour periods or 700 billion years to do it, that's irrelevant. If we say God, out of nothing, can create the universe and had such a sense of humor that he made you and me in his image. That takes some ability to laugh at yourself. Can you imagine God looking down from heaven and as if he's looking in a mirror, seeing you and me? Anyway, if that's the sort of God we have, then believing in a God who can make a pubescent girl in a village backwater in Israel pregnant is not a major leap of faith. Of course, there are questions. Why Mary? Why Nazareth? Why at that time? And all of that is answered clearly by Paul in the Epistle to the Galatians. When the right time finally came, he said, God sent his own son. He came as a son of a human mother and lived under the Jewish law to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might all become God's children. So you say to the skeptical world around us, I believe in the virgin birth. And they scoff. How can you believe in something so as a virgin giving birth to a son? So just a few things to share with you on that subject. Mary was probably around 12 when Gabriel appeared at her family home in Nazareth. You can imagine what she must have felt. A 12-year-old girl in her room. There's Gabriel. Oh, help! You can imagine Gabriel had to say to her in the Greek, me phobos, do not fear, because she must have been terrified by this. And she was engaged, but not married. Not married because they were waiting for her to begin menstruating so that she could marry. There was no point marrying somebody that didn't have the potential to give you an heir. That's how it worked back at that point. Joseph would have been born, probably he's about 14, and when he was born, his family would have started looking around thinking, where is there a likely girl that we can marry our son to? And all of it would have been arranged as soon as Mary was born. They would have grown up for their 12 or 14 years knowing that's going to be my husband. That's going to be my wife. There wasn't any sense of them having to fall in love or sign up to some sort of online dating site. They knew from the very beginning. And if you add the ages, Mary at 12 or 13 giving birth to Jesus, who traditionally lived 33 years before he was crucified, that would mean that Mary was 46-ish when the Christian message was beginning to be told. And Luke writes his gospel because he isn't content that the story is adequately told by the others. And you will know from Luke's gospel, particularly those of you who have read the Bible in a year, that Luke goes on more about the birth of Jesus than anybody else. Mark and John are silent on the details. Matthew takes another approach, and it's only Luke that goes from this story of the Annunciation, first of all to John the Baptist's mother Elizabeth, and then to Mary, and then through the birth of Jesus. And he's probably writing, now this is important, in about the year 70. And the eyewitnesses, those who were there, those who knew the story as Mary had told it, as Jesus had told it, they would still have been around, maybe even been part of it. Where in all of history do you find anybody correcting the gospel accounts at the time? Who stands up in the first century world and said, oh, you got it wrong. You've told us lies about Jesus. Because you know, if somebody could have, they would have. And so Luke's record stands. And he was a physician. He knew how the body worked. And so he must have had very strong reasons for recording Mary's words. How can this be since I am a virgin? Or if you prefer it in the Authorized Version, which is quite clear, since I have known not a man. So there we go. The virgin is essential because it demonstrates both the divinity and the humanity of Jesus. The simple fact that a mother gives birth to a baby clearly shows that Jesus is human. But alongside that, the statement from Gabriel makes it clear that the conception is not normal. The Holy Spirit will come upon you and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Makes it clear that is God's work, not human work. And Matthew records that Joseph, after a bit of argy-bargy, accepts this and respects this story. And it says And the Bible's quite explicit in this. He had no marital relations with her until she bore a son. And the marriage of humanity and divinity in Jesus, conceived in the womb of a virgin, is unique in human history and is vital to it, the incarnation. Now, don't get me wrong, there are other supernatural births in Scripture, but they are not emasculate conceptions. Isaac, Samson, Samuel, and John the Baptist, none of them make any claim to procreation involving anything other than both a mother and a father. Their willingness, the parent, to engage in cuddling is an expression of their faith in what God had promised them in a child, especially so with Abraham and Sarah, who at 100 are thinking, we've got to make a baby now. We better put it in the diary for a week on Thursday, and we'll take a rest before. And you can imagine it, can't you? It's quite clear in all the Bible that everyone else has a mum and a dad, but not in this miracle. God will do something different, and it's Mary's innocence. Can be, since I'm a virgin, probably her mum had told her about the birds and bees, but she hadn't experienced it, and she says that. And some make the observation that apart from Matthew and Luke, the New Testament makes no mention of the virgin birth and suggests that this means it isn't something that's important to the early church. You know, some theologians, they need taking out and given a good talking to. Why don't they mention it in this first generation? Because it had been assumed. It was accepted that Jesus is born of a virgin. It wasn't something to talk about or debate. It was simple fact. And in John 1, it says, the Word became assumed flesh and dwelt among us. That's shocking to the Hebrews, to the Greeks, to everybody who was around, who was thinking at the time, to say that the Word became flesh is so mind-blowing. They could understand a God who came down to earth and assumed humanity as a God wearing a coat, but becoming human, that is something else. So our God, in Jesus, steps out of timelessness into time. And from the freedom of holding all the universe in his hand at one time, to be confined in a body to one place. And then I suppose finally, if we take the miracle of the virgin birth away, we take away the plausibility of all miracles, and we then become a really hopeless people, because that would include the resurrection. And you and I, in this Advent season, as we look forward to the second coming of Christ, depend on that we will be raised to be with God forever. And I personally tire of any faith that doesn't make demands on us, demands on our time, our money, our service, and intellectually to challenge us to know that when God acts, we don't understand, we accept it. We believe. We don't avoid it, we believe it. And as the Creed says, and as we will repeatedly say through the year, I believe in Jesus Christ, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. I believe in the virgin birth. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand. Using words from the Athanasian Creed, we proclaim the Church's faith in Jesus Christ. We believe and declare that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is both divine and human, God of the being of the Father, the only Son from before time began, human from the being of his mother, born in the world, fully God and fully human, human in both mind and body. As God, he is equal to the Father. As human, he is less than the Father. Although he is both divine and human, he is not two beings, but one Christ. One not by turning God into flesh, but by taking humanity into God. Truly one, not by mixing humanity with Godhead, but by being one person. For as mind and body form one human being, so the one Christ is both divine and human. The Word became flesh and lived among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So we pray for the Church and for the world, and we thank God for his blessing.
Lord God, we join our prayers with those of Mary, your faithful servant and mother of our Lord, to proclaim your greatness and sing in gratitude for all your wonderful gifts given to us, your lowly servants. Lord, look down with love upon our church as we focus on the coming of your kingdom and the gift of your Son this Christmas. Lord, in your mercy, Mary prayed that the mighty be cast down from their thrones. We pray that those in power would use that power wisely and compassionately, so that the lowly would be lifted up, the hungry fed, and greater equality be established between rich and poor. Lord, in your mercy. Mary's prayer was given to God whilst on a visit to her cousin Elizabeth. At this time of Advent and Christmas, we pray for all relatives and friends, especially those we cannot see. We ask that we are always aware of your presence with us and with all those we love. Lord, in your mercy, Mary recognized your promise of mercy. Lord, we ask you to show your mercy to all who are sick, fearful, or in mourning, and especially we pray for those members of our church, families and friends, who we now name before you. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of eternal life. Bless those who mourn and those who have died. In particular, we remember Sheila Joy Burns, and Clive Ivan Henry. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, who chose the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of the promised Saviour, fill us with your grace, that in all things we may embrace your holy will, and with her rejoice in your salvation. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace and glory in the highest. Peace of the Lord be always with you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made, will become for us the
blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Come, O come, Emmanuel, you are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the true vine and living bread. Make us your servants ready for his coming in these holy mysteries, and when he comes in glory, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. Good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, everlasting, through Jesus Christ, your Son. He is the one foretold by all the prophets, whom the Virgin Mother bore with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist was his herald and made him known when at last he came. In his love, Christ fills us with joy as we prepare to celebrate his birth, so that when he comes again, he may find us watching in prayer to celebrate his birth, so that when he comes again, he may, do that sentence again, in his love, Christ fills us with joy as we prepare to celebrate his birth, so that when he comes again, he may find us watching in prayer, our hearts filled with wonder and praise. And so with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. The same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Christ is the bread of life.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, Lord Jesus, until you come in glory. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world,
grant
us peace. This is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you,
but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
This is the body of Christ.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, who chose the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of the promised Saviour,
bless your servants with your grace, that in all things we may embrace your holy will, and with them rejoice
in your salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would have to be blind, deaf, and incontinent not to have got the point today that this service celebrates the Mother of our Lord, the Virgin Mary. We look forward in this coming week to celebrating his birth, whom she worshipped and we adore. I've been reminded that I didn't tell you the time of the live stream for Nine Lessons tonight, in which we begin that celebration. And it will be at 5 p.m. and available thereafter. I believe in the virgin birth, and I hope you do too. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May God himself, the God of peace, make you perfect and holy, and keep you safe and blameless in spirit, soul, and body for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
As we await our coming Saviour, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. In glory.